Today's video is going to give you another inside the mind gameplay as I play Madden 16, guys. Just want to kind of bring up some topics as they come up and just kind of illustrate my thought process and things that are going through my head as I play the game, you know, this in today's gameplay. So what we want to do with this, guys, if you guys don't know, what I like to do here is I like to basically just play the game and talk about issues as they come up. And what I mean by this, what I think this accomplishes is it allows us to not only give it a case-by-case scenario to give you a bunch of different looks at things, which I think are important. Some interesting pressure. Interesting pressure there. What we want to do with this, basically here, is provide you guys an opportunity to give some live commentary, to give you some case-by-case scenarios as they come up, and hopefully shed some light on the different things that we can come to expect in this game. So what you're seeing here real quick, for those of you, is he's using this guy, I think it's Jacquez Smith or something, running strong safety scrape 3 out of the 3-4 under. This is a B-gap pressure, and he's basically going to user this right side guy and manually fake blitz him. So that's something that's interesting to note first and foremost. If you didn't catch, obviously I started this commentary a little late because I wanted to show this gameplay, but basically the first in the first possession, I got an interception, and then gave me some good field position. Ended up wasting the field position, as you can see there, by getting in a third and long. And that's something that's interesting to me, is wasting your mistakes. And I find that this issue arises mainly with me specifically because I don't really do a good job of taking advantage of plays that I've already made, like interceptions and things like that. You know, because I try to do a little bit too much at times on the offensive side of the ball, and I know that I'm not alone in that. I know that, you know, several people have often lamented that this is also their struggle. And so with that in mind, you know, hopefully on the next drive I'll take more advantage of it if I get the same opportunity. But basically what we try to do here with this is kind of open up at the game here. Defensively, we're trying to play bend but don't break, and that was a really good run there. Caught me off balance. I think I messed up my audible set. But what we try to do is kind of fill it out. Don't want to try to do anything too crazy in the opening kind of sections of the game. We notice, one of the things we note is that cover 3 is very weak this year in terms of coverage deep. And so if our opponent's going to try to, you know, hit me deep, I want to know that early on. Now, when you have guys with high zone and man, it actually makes it a little bit more of an option for you. But as a whole, you know, you don't really want to be playing a whole lot of cover 3 in this year's game. Now, I've actually been playing a lot of cover 3 as I just get raped by Todd Gurley. So Todd Gurley's been becoming a really popular back in this year's game. So terrible way to start off the commentary. Inside zone, basic inside zone run houses me. Now see, that's what we cannot have in this year's game. What just happened, this is something that I'm really working on, is not being beat early on in the game, not beating yourself. This whole kind of mindset on how to play the game has actually stemmed from this season. And one of the things that I've been doing a lot of is kind of paying attention to real NFL and just trying to see a lot of what they call. You see a lot of cover 2 man. You see a lot of you know, plays like that. You know, basic coverages, basic cover 2 buck or cover 2 man. That kind of play a bend but don't break style. You know, really, especially when you pay attention to how the Denver Broncos are playing this year. You see a lot of cover 2 man in their defenses, and not a ton of blitzing. So that's something interesting to me. Now, Seattle, a team that plays a lot of cover 3, one of the reasons they're able to play a lot of cover 3 is because of those big corners. You know, obviously at their peak with Brandon Brown and Sherman, but now going with Williams and Sherman. So just a couple of interesting things to kind of consider as you're playing this game. Now, as we get into this one specifically, we're noticing that he is using a manual, kind of not a manual rush, but a manual blitz off that edge. So one of the things that I'm going to try to do here is just try to mess around with my line, try to do some slide protection and things of that nature to kind of, you know, eliminate this pressure. We're going to see as this goes on how this works, but we're going to first try pinching our defensive line. Here we see it come through again. Now, what we're going to notice is that this pressure is going to leave him vulnerable to certain areas of the field. And so what I want to do here, and what I really want to do, is be able to take Keenan Allen and motion him across, but I don't think I'm going to be able to. So I'm just going to slide protect to the left here. I'm going to motion Sanders into the gap and pick that up, pick that pressure up nice and clean, and then deliver the ball to Julian Edelman on that nice little speed out. He's not going to be able to stop that speed out because you have to kind of user it, honestly. If you call press man, we're going to call a different play there. But for me, And I don't, third and four is really not a good down to play with here. We're going to go zone of seams. And, actually, no, we're going to go zone of post. Same play. We'll just call the same play here. Slide protect to the right this time. We're going to bring Keenan Allen in. Like so. We're able to hit that speed out again for easy first down. We notice that the pressure, for the most part, is picked up when we slide to the left or to the right. If we pinch the line, it doesn't quite do a good job. So as long as he's going to run that pressure, we're going to use this kind of slide protection here. Here we're going to look to slide right and try to pick that pressure up. And almost got in trouble. Guys, if you don't have this Reggie Bush card, I can't really... I can't really see. This looks to be like a quarter blitz, cover two style pressure. But guys, real quick on this Reggie Bush card, I don't remember what his rating is, but if you go to mutthead.com, it's a site where you can look up players, and basically Reggie Bush is one of the top receiving backs, and he's really not very expensive. Here we see him go back to this 3-4 under look. We're going to try to actually pick this up with our standard pressure pickup. We're going to slide protect here to the left side of the line of scrimmage, see if we can pick that pressure up. If not, we're going to try to quickly release the ball to the flats and see here. And we are actually able to pick that pressure up and able to also deliver the speed out to Julian Edelman. And so seemingly we've kind of boxed this pressure that was actually giving us some trouble on the first drive. So it's important, guys, the idea of adjusting, trying different slide protections throughout the game. Obviously being aware of all the blitzes actually helps you in the long run because you're able to kind of dissect it a little quicker. But you can't always be prepared, and you're gonna have to face something new every time you play the game. So just keep that in mind. But anyway, here we got the crossing pattern again. Julian Edelman is gonna have a hard time stopping this crossing pattern. We're actually gonna get in for six. We couldn't get in for six there, but he's gonna have a hard time stopping that crossing pattern as long as he continues this motif of this manual pressure. So that's something that we need to definitely pay attention to as the game goes on. We come into this single back bunch. Now, those of you who have watched a couple of my videos in the past, what you're gonna find is we use a lot of. The single back bunch ace. We also use it in combination with a couple of other formations here. We're going to have to go ahead and take a timeout here. Guys, don't be afraid to take timeouts early on in the game, especially in the first half. In the first half, it's not as important to kind of have those timeouts available to you. So what we're going to be able to do here, though, is it's really a chess match here. Just kind of come out and see what he kind of gives us. I like to audible a couple different times just to kind of see how he's going to move, how he's going to react, do some playmakers and things like that, just to kind of see his motif and then try to run just a basic running play here that kind of is going to keep us set up. Now, we don't want to use that toss. We kind of want to, you saw that I come out in the quick pitch. I come out in that because it's going to allow me to get to some other plays that I want to run. But we really want to use that pitch sparingly because it is such an opportunity for a loss. So we really kind of start out with the inside zone, and then we go back to the quick pitch. Here we're going to reset the play, go right into the quick pitch. We're going to see we got outside leverage, and Jerick McKinnon, he couldn't beat him to the edge there. That Jaquez Smith is really making a lot of big-time plays for him. So in a third and goal situation, and this, I often sub injury Archer. Unfortunately, I think I just forgot to. But in this situation, we're going to do some things here. Now, noting that we've been running the ball to the left most of the game here out of this formation, we're going to now pass it to the left side and attempt to hit Keenan Allen in the end zone on a quick little pass here, and ends up getting batted. No one really was open in that one, so we're going to have to take a field goal. Actually, no, we're not. We're going to go ahead and go for this. And the reason I'm going to go for this is I feel that this play from the Snugs is going to be able to do a nice job of potentially getting me into the end zone. So what we're looking to do with this is we're looking to hit Julian Edelman. So we're going to slide protect to the left to kind of shut down his pressure. And we're going to try to hit Edelman, and we get a nice catch in traffic animation. And that was probably something we don't want to look to kind of get again. We really probably need to kind of make sure that we're kind of maybe using fullback dive or some more prevalent tactics. Tried to kind of out-chest him with that quick pass, and didn't really work out for me too well. But I think Dre Archer's going to be able to kind of explode to that corner. We're really banking on being able to hit that quick pitch when we want to, especially when he's bringing those guys inside. So that substitution there, you saw how important that was. It potentially could have cost me not only a loss of 7 points, but maybe even a loss of possession, because Jerick McKinnon just isn't as fast as Dre Archer, and that's kind of important for what we're trying to do here. Here we get a great squib kick, and we actually recover the football. So that's kind of why we like to do that. It's not really a squib kick; it's kind of a booch kick, and basically the heart behind it is we really don't want to give up kick returns. Every now and then you'll get some kind of crazy thing to happen where you're going to be able to maybe get a fumble off a hit stick, or maybe even like we just saw, just a recovery because they fail to pick up the football. So here we've got a one-on-one with Kelvin Benjamin, and we're going to try to moss him. Unfortunately, we don't get it. Noticing that they're in cover three is important. This blitz that he's running, the strong safety scrape three, it's out of a cover three shell. And the important part about cover three shells, it's going to leave him vulnerable. He's going to leave him very vulnerable to the user catches, to the user catch streaks, to the user catch corners, those kind of things. And so we're able to take advantage of that in that scenario. We don't want to hit that every time, but obviously sometimes. And he ended up getting the pressure in that time. I think I forgot to slide. So 3rd and 18, now noticing first of all that there's 1:47 on the clock, we want to take this clock down. And really what we're going to do here is we're going to try to hit him in this cover 3 shell. So that's the whole heart of this. So we're going to try to hit him in this cover 3 shell. Now we know that he is, we're going to just block our running backs. We're going to power block. We're going to end up motioning Sanders across and blocking him. But first we always take all the clock off here. Bring him over. He's in this cover three shell. Kelvin Benjamin is going to one-on-one, and there you see it. Very big catch there for us, because what happened there is we make him pay for that cover three shell. When you blitz from a cover three shell this year, and I actually do blitz from a cover three shell a lot, it leaves you vulnerable to those user catch corners from the Arizona playbook. Now, you guys can check that out in our offensive guide. You can find that below. We're actually coming out with an updated version any day now, so be on the lookout for that. But definitely want to check that out. Here I'm going to try to audible real quick to this Ace Twins inside zone. If I can get the playoff, and I am able to get it off. And just kinda, in that situation, what you saw there was I didn't have a chance to bounce it outside, so I spun it back inside. Was able to kind of keep myself in position. Sometimes, you know, it's not always about trying to make the big play, but rather it's sometimes simply about making the small play that's going to keep you in position here. So here we want to take the clock down. We want to make sure we're taking the clock down in these situations because of the time on the clock and the fact that we're trying to go up by a possession, but really we're trying to go down by a possession by a touchdown. And so even if we take a field goal here, it's actually going to be beneficial to us. So here, just a basic inside zone to Dre Archer. We're going to try to pound it up the middle, and he ends up stopping us. Now that's fine. Now he has to take a timeout here. He's not going to. So we need to get into our play, and we need to get into it quick. We can go a zone of post. We're going to take a timeout here. With 7 seconds left, it's going to give us the opportunity to run one more play, even two if we want to take our time or whatever. And then it's also going to give us that opportunity here. And what we see here is the safety is not brought down. He doesn't bring the safety down. He actually has him brought down on the left side, so that's something that we haven't seen yet. So what we want to do in this situation, we have Sanders on this hitch route, and then we want to take Keenan Allen, put him on a curl, and we're really looking to hit Julian Edelman. Now make sure we're pinching our line just in case he sends pressure. And nothing. Playmaker. Oh, that was terrible. So one of the things that you saw me do, and that was probably one of the biggest mistakes I've made in a long time, and I make about 15 mistakes a game, so that for me to say that is what you saw there. In that situation, what you want to do, which I did not do, and it's mainly just because I was aware, if that makes any sense. What I didn't do was I didn't throw the ball away. Nothing was there. Nothing was open. And really, I was trying to score a touchdown. And I should have just paid attention to the clock. With nothing open, I should have just thrown the football away. Very simple. Should have just thrown the football away, and we would have been fine. Would have taken my points, and that would have been that. But unfortunately, I didn't do that, and that's really a big mistake there. And so it's going to put me in a bad situation now. And now we see that his blitz has been picked up. He's going to everybody's defense, two man under, and the snugs. What I love about this is that it really makes two man under tough to run. You really can't run two man under against the snugs here. So. This is going to be easy pickings for us as we work down the field here. Send some basic pressure. Again, goes with the, I think, a zone look there. We're able to hit the speed out. And the speed out is a foundation of the offense. Really, a lot of people already know about the speed out, but I see that, you know, in a lot of situations, people don't really run this the right way. And so we're able to really take advantage of that. So that's really what we look to do here. In this play, we're looking to hit this quick pattern out here. He's going to take that away. Man, that Jaquez Smith is freaking, he is playing ball today. He is playing ball. Man. So, basically, we have to really contend with a solid pass rush. Something I haven't really had to face. You know, just a manual pass rush. Very simple. All right, so here, look to the flat. And we're able to hit this flat to Reggie Bush. We got to get upfield, and that's terrible user stick. Basically, just a matter of user stick. Really was a good read, but just unfortunately, I made a bad play. It really is the core of what just happened there, was I just made a bad play. Now, needing with the necessity for me to block a halfback is going to change kind of the way I play this. Really trying to get this pass protection down. Able to get that high pass lead against the cover two. One of the things I want, and I stressed this in the last video as well, when facing cover two, or actually when facing any zone coverage, try out the high pass lead, guys. For me, the high pass lead has actually made a really big impact on how I'm playing the game this year, and I really think it could maybe impact you guys some too, as you guys look to play here. Here's zone of seams, and gosh, Emmanuel Sanders needs to make that play. I don't know what happened there. I use Tony Romo at quarterback. That's mainly just because he's the best. He's the most accurate. If I was going to go with a budget quarterback, I don't spend a whole lot of coin. But I think that on the quarterback, it's actually kind of justified. You need that accurate quarterback this year. That was a terrible read. So, and see how it's coming back to bite me that I didn't take that field goal, or that I made that really poor clock management choice. And here we are in a situation where I kind of need that. So that's really something that's worth noting. In this situation, we're trying to hit one of these crossing patterns, and we're able to hit Emmanuel Sanders with a blocker in front of us and get a big first down. So that's a big play for the offense right there in a situation that really wasn't looking too good for us at third and long. Being able to pick that up, he was focused so much on that left side, on that right side out routes and things, that he forgot to pay attention to the other routes on the play. And there we try that high pass lead again. Romo makes a bad throw. I'm finding that a lot of bad throws are a result of really, if you try to precision, or not precision pass, but total control pass. If you try to do this, you actually have a lot of bad throws. So if you can, try not to precision pass. Mainly just hold L1. So they're high pass lead, no precision. We're able to catch that football. Whereas the last play, which you guys saw, was with precision, or with, not precision, but TCP, by holding the left analog stick, we weren't able to pick that up. So that is something that I think is very important as you guys continue on this process of trying to get better at this game. Here, looking to hit Bush. Nothing. In this situation, we have all the time we need. No blitzing of anybody, really. And we'll see what he decides to do. And we're just patient. We're just patient here. Trying to find somebody in the back of the end zone until he rushes. Stay in the pocket, guys. Do not get out of the pocket here. It's very important. Because as long as you don't get in the pocket, then you're able to find someone like a Reggie Bush in the back of the end zone. I think we're going to get called for a pass, a flag, illegal touching, and it's going to force us to take our field goal. Now, really, that's not really our fault, honestly, because, first of all, I mean, it's really hard for me to see whether or not my receiver goes out of bounds, and I know that may be on me, but at the core, you know, that was a fairly effective drive, but now you're kind of seeing why it was so important for me to get that field goal, because in a situation like where if I would have taken a field goal at the end of half, I would be up by 7 points, a full touchdown, as opposed to only 4 points, where if he scores, he's now ahead. So you kind of see the dilemma, and really, as a result of me making that big-time mistake, and that mistake did cost me, as you can see here. So we've only been on defense, I think, twice. In the first drive, we played well. Second drive, we did not play well. So I haven't seen a ton of what he wants to do outside of inside zone, which is what everybody wants to do. So I'm not really I kind of want to still be in this fill-out mode of what he wants to do. So we'll see if we can't do that and try to counter his A-gap pressure with some pressure of our own. There it is, inside zone. From what I find, this play, Overload 3 Seam, does a lot of things for me, one of which is it stops the inside zone fairly well, especially if they try to bounce it wide. And there's a one-on-one, and he's going to take advantage of that, and that is number 10. Is that Martavis Bryant against Jimmy Smith? Interesting. So there you see, again, that weakness of the cover 3 pressure, and we deal with that. And then you see, I mean, I think it's even now. I think he's got one, and I've got one. So something that I need to do, though, Jimmy Smith has a man corner. I need to be manning these guys up on the outside when playing the cover 3 shell. If they go deep, I now have a shot at man coverage rating as opposed to zone coverage rating. So that's interesting. Make sure you know your players, your personnel, things that you've got coming in. And there's a big-time interception. And I brought it up because I didn't know if it would have been a safety or a touchback, but a big time interception there. And the reason we were able to you saw our user really kind of played into that. We were able to user it, and what I find is that that's kind of a big pattern for us. So now against the strong safety blitz, he's going to have some trouble stopping the run to the left side, I'm pretty sure. And there we're able to get Dre Archer out in the open field, let him use that 96 speed, I think is what he's got. He's second, I think he's this. I think there's the most feared card is actually the better one, but it's very, very expensive. I think not very expensive, but it's like 20K, and I don't really feel 20K is worth one speed point. So I kind of stuck with the standard Archer that's only like 2K. Here we got an inside zone of our own, noting that again the weakness of that strong safety pressure is off that right edge. It's that right or not that le- not that right edge? Sorry, the left edge. The left edge is very weak against that off tackle kind of style run. In a heavy run set like this single back bunch ace, we're able to exploit that. And really in a closing section of the game, if we can close this out, if we can make a good drive here, it's going to really, really going to say a lot. So here, again, going back to this. Now, my consideration, he's going to have to overplay this. So what we're going to do is we're going to kind of try a little trickery here. Go to a little quick pass game. And a little quick pass game to kind of shake him up a little bit. And we see he actually run commits down against this. So in this situation, we're going to go to the pistol. And we're going to go to the play smash. This is going to give us an interesting dynamic here, and really just looking basic. And then if we don't have anything, so we don't have anything, so we just run straight ahead, get that first down. That's the key. In this situation, it's not necessarily important to, be able to dot him up and down the field. What we're trying to do here is move the chains, work the clock game, force him to have to start using his timeouts. That's the core of what we're doing. And you saw, a big time. A big time play, in my opinion, there. So here he seems like see how the safety doesn't come down. This is a tell that he's probably not running that pressure. He's probably either running a different pressure or really not running any pressure at all. Here he sends all of his guys. We're able to hit that quick flat pass to Reggie Bush, who has great catching and good agility. He's going to take it to the house for 6. Puts us in a great position in the game now. Now in this situation, do we go for 2 or do we go for 1? I normally go for 2. Here we're up by 10 points. We would like to be up by 2 complete touchdowns. So we go for 2 here. You could go for 1 and really it gets the same result. But if he goes, if he scores and then he goes for 2, then you're going to only be up by 3 points. But if he scores and goes for 2 and you get this 2-pointer, you're now in a really, really good position where you're up not just by one score and a field goal, but 2 scores. And none of them could be field goals. He has to score 2 touchdowns. Being up by 12 as opposed to being up by 11 is maybe, it's actually a really significant difference in your lead. One of them requires 2 possessions, one of them being a field goal, and then one of them requires 2 possessions, both of them being touchdowns. The difference between touchdowns and field goals is really a difference between wins and losses sometimes. So it's very important to me to go ahead and get up by 2 touchdowns instead of 2 field goals. So. Defensively, with 1 minute 20 seconds left, you're not going to see me play any more situations where I have single safety. And what I mean by that is you're not going to see any more cover 3 from me. You're going to see cover 2 man a lot. You're going to see a lot of pass committing, but you see this one-on-one, and then we have that safety over top to help us and that's really what we're looking at. And see, he's only attempted four passes, two for interceptions. So he hasn't really been able to pass on us. So that's something. I just need to get over here top, over the top, over the top. Here we're able to send the hounds and get a nice stop. So, you know, this is really bomb time, and he needs a lot of yards fast. And he's kind of, in my opinion, he probably should be trying to bomb me after this drive, after he goes down and gets a touchdown, but he's kind of choosing now. And so we've got two bombs, one on either side. We're able to send them basic heat. He's got a max protect situation, and it looks like he's probably going to go ahead and quit out here. So, guys, if you guys want to purchase this offense and defense, you can do that in the description. I have both playbooks broken down. But as you can see, some of the game strategy. Hopefully you guys are enjoying this video series as we take a little deeper look into kind of why I do the things I do, kind of a case-by-case scenario as it's